And welcome to Galaxy Moonbeam Night Site. We are the retro talk program for nostalgia and baby boomer stuff here on the Galaxy Nostalgia Network. I'm Smitty.
I'm Mike.
And we welcome you to another episode of Galaxy Moonbeam Night Site. We're so happy to have you with us. We got a great show lined up for you. Joining us in the studio once again is our very good friend, the proprietor, owner of Mantiques in Santee, California, our good friend Tom McCoy. Tom, welcome back to Galaxy Moonbeam Nightside.
Oh, well, thank you. It's a pleasure to be here.
Yeah, pleasure to have you back with us again. We're going to start off talking this program about something that's close to your heart and close to my heart as fellow radio collectors, and that is novelty radios and television sets. Now, first of all, before we get into that, we'll talk a little bit later about your shop, but in your shop, Mantiques, in Santee, California, you've got a wide variety of radios and collectibles of all kinds, knives and airplanes and toys and political things and all kinds of neat stuff, and we'll tell people how they can get a hold of you a little bit later. But one thing that we wanted to cover on this show was novelty radios and novelty TV sets, and I know that you're familiar with a lot of those. We've seen a lot of them going back even to the tube days. You know, people sometimes think of transistor sets that are novelties. They're shaped either like a package of McDonald's French fries or a can of orange juice or a tire or a gas pump or something, but you've seen a lot of these. What comes to mind when you think of novelty radios and TV sets?
The one that I like, it was a made by Westinghouse Refrigerators. It was actually a novelty radio that they give away when you bought a refrigerator, believe it or not. They would give you this radio and an unbelievable nice little heavy transistor radio. And, of course, like we've said before, back then, everything that they made, it was built to last. Not like today, everything's throwaway. But the transistor radios back then, they were just as well made as radio, you know. But everybody did it. I mean, they had microphones and oil cans and batteries and cigarette packs. They just unbelievable, all the different items that was designed as a novelty radio.
And I remember that even going back even further, and I don't know if you could classify it as a novelty radio, but even going back to the 1930s, remember they had those custom-made bar radios that were just basically either a big Philco or RCA radio that was put in a custom cabinet, and it actually had doors that would open, and you had a full bar set in there with the glasses and the decanters for the various liquors and the spoons to stir it up with. And I kind of consider those a kind of a novelty radio.
No, those were dual purpose, and those were very interesting. In fact, Tom had one in his store. It was called a Smokerette, and it was from the late 40s, 47. We've got that in our Galaxy Gallery on display, thanks to Tom, but it was, everybody smoked.
Sure.
Whether you smoked cigars or pipes or cigarettes, it didn't matter, but just about everybody in the 40s smoked of adult age and some before adult age, and this was a radio, a nice, attractive tabletop radio that had, was an AM dial radio, and it had an ashtray, and it had a little lineup, the little brackets across the back where a guy could put his smoking pipes, and then it had little canisters, humidors, three or four, I think it was, where one could keep his pipe tobacco. And I guess the idea is sit there, put it on a table next to your easy chair, listen to your radio while you were smoking your pipe. Very functional. And I guess it could be called novelty radio, but these were actually pieces of furniture, just like the bar radio that we talked about, Smitty. But there were so many brands that were offered as promotional items in the disguise of being a transistor radio. George Halilakos, our good guy George, we're talking about Dodger, going to the Dodger games in the 60s. There was one time when KABC 790 got together with the Dodgers, and everybody that went to the game one afternoon got a Dodger KABC transistor radio. It was a little 8-transistor, El Cheapo, Japanese transistor radio. I think it's 62 or 63. You see those on eBay now, and it advertised the radio station along with the baseball team. You got them that were in the design of Winston Cigarette, Marlboro cigarettes, candy bars.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I had one. It was Elvis Presley. I also had one. It was the shape of a Coke bottle, and you twist half the bottle, and the AM station would come on, and you twist the bottom half, and you change the channel. So they're remarkable that over the years, because if you think about it, well, in my day growing up, 50s and 60s, probably your most direct form of communication was a little transistor radio you had stuck in your ear most of the time, definitely at night. But you'd go to the beach, you'd have your transistor radio, and you go riding around on the bus, you'd have your transistor. Tom, you've got some nice transistor radios in your shop. In fact, you've got a couple of Mickey Mouse clock radios, some GE Mickey Mouse that are there on display in the shop. But you see these come in, don't those instantly bring you back to a different time when you were growing up and that was your form of communication?
Oh, yeah.
Did you live on the radio, too? The radio put me, I was going through little 9-volt batteries every 2 days because I'd fall asleep with the radio on next to my head and the pillow.
I have a really cool transistor radio, so to speak. It was designed by the Telefunken, and it was made to go into a Volkswagen bus. And it slid into the dash of the bus and connected on the back, and that then you had your radio in the bus. But when you got to the beach, you just pulled it out, and it operated off of batteries. You take it out on the beach and listen to it. And that was back in the 60s, you know. And I'm talking about a nice-sized, heavy-duty radio, too. It was well-made and a lot of fun radios like that, you know.
Now, was that introduced by Volkswagen as an enhanced?
It was made for Volkswagen.
Okay.
Yeah, it was made for Volkswagen. It was a German company called Telefunken. And they made Grundigs and other radios, too, but very well-made radio.
So you get your VW van, and you bought it, and it didn't have a radio. That was the answer to it. You go get that Telefunken, which they probably had those advertised in the magazines, VW magazines.
Oh, yeah.
And you'd buy that, and it was a portable, but also plugged in. See how we talk about this show and nostalgia and things that come full circle, Smitty?
Mm-hmm.
That's how you do it nowadays. The face of the radio comes off for security. When you go to buy a radio nowadays for your car or a CD player, and see, this was happening in the 50s and 60s with VW micro campers, microvans.
Yeah, exactly.
And Telefunken, that wasn't a cheap piece of equipment. That's right up there with some of the higher-end things we've talked about. That was probably a very valuable high-cost radio to assemble. How much did you know how much those retailed for when a guy bought one?
No, I can't remember what they sold for, but, you know, really they were an expensive radio to buy at the time, you know. Of course, now it's kind of relative, but at the time, you know, not too many people would have them because of the cost,
We see all kinds of different things that we talk about in one thing, the American pop culture, the center of American pop culture will always have to be the little Japanese transistor radio, because that was when there was one television in the home. And if your dad came home at a decent hour like my dad did, your vote didn't even get counted on
you watched
time.
What dad wanted
you
to
got
watch.
To watch. Even if you weren't a Wagon Train fan, you were going to be watching Major Adams and the Wagon Train, whether you liked it or not. Or you could go to bed, go to your room, and turn on your little transistor radio, listen to Wolfman Jack or KHJ, KFWB. But there really wasn't any choices. Now, you've got your smartphone here. There's thousands of stations, streaming radio stations, and video TV that you could be watching anytime you want.
Sure.
Let the Wagon Train roll on. It doesn't matter. I got my own 1,000-channel set right here in my next to my head.
Yeah, exactly. Tom, these novelty radios, are there people that collect these exclusively, that they have a collection of novelty radios, or is that something that people, for example, they might have one or two novelty radios in their general collection? How does that work?
No, there's a few serious collectors out there, and that's all they collect is the novelty radios. And then some even generalize, they just want the cigarette packs, or they just want the oil cans or the batteries or whatever. But for the most part, you know, a lot of the people that come in today, it's funny because, you know, they don't remember even seeing a novelty radio like that. They remember the little transistors, but they don't remember the the oil cans or microphones or whatever. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. But now they made so many of them, it's just unbelievable.
And I imagine that somebody who's collecting either transistor radios or old radios in general might see a novelty radio and say, hey, this is cool. I'm going to add this to my collection and then begin collecting them that way.
Yeah, absolutely, yeah.
Do you see mostly transistor sets as novelty radios, or do you also see some of the tube ones now and again?
No. Once in a while, they come in and they think they're transistors, but they're not. They're actually were tube right before the transition of a transistor radio come about. They were portable radios, but they are still tube, and they were battery-operated. And a lot of those are considered novelty radios, too, yes.
Yeah, absolutely, yeah.
Tom, we've had some questions come in from the Galaxy gang out there. In fact, we are international now, Smitty.
Yes, we are.
Because I believe this question came in on email from the United Kingdom, or Wales, about the portable radios, the old RCAs, I guess they were tubes, you guys clear me up, but they're portable, but they ran on dry cells.
Mm-hmm.
And dry cells and a lot of the radios were put away. They found their way to a garage in a cardboard box, and they see the light of day 50, 60 years later, and guess what? Somebody didn't take the batteries out.
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Question being, Tom, and this one's a good one for you, Tom, can these be salvaged if a battery's been left in and you got that ugly, mungy green stuff and who knows what else leaking out of there? Leaking out of the battery crevices, will that radio ever live to play music again, or is it finished?
No, actually, it can be repaired. There's companies out there that make the new packs for them, or you can sometimes clean them up and repair them yourself. But yeah, that's always sad whenever they bring in a transistor radio. That's the first thing I do is I open it up and. And guess what? The batteries are still in it, been in it for 20 years, yeah. And it just, it looks, sometimes looks worse than it really is, but in some cases it actually runs the radio, you should never leave the batteries in there, but they can be repaired. In fact, I've repaired several of them for customers, and like I said, there is companies out there where you can buy parts and battery holders for those certain radios.
I've actually dealt with, of all things, a couple of transistor transoceanics that had the batteries left in them once upon a time, and the little springs, that hold the batteries in, and I've had to actually splice in another spring to hold the batteries in place. And Mike, I think you told us a horror story one time or two about the toys that have had batteries left in there that have been ruined.
Yeah, I'm a wind-up and battery-operated toy collector. That's pretty much my first passion, and I don't know how many times I've just stood there right in front of the seller with a broken heart because you have a toy, a Japanese battery-operated car, for instance, from the mid-50s. And pristine, and in that case we were talking about on show, I think it was show 41, we were talking about toys. This had the original box, which just triples the value
right.
When you got the box, because the litho print on the top of the box of these cars, even marks and line mark, were works of art in themselves, these color. Open this up, car's beautiful, get underneath it, and uh-oh. And open it up, and it looks as though somebody had poured some kind of mixture of split pea soup and root beer into this thing and let it dry.
Yeah.
And it destroyed, I would say, most of the value. What you've got is a display piece, but the heartbreaker is you turned about a $3,000 collectible battery-operated toy into about a $300 display-only
right.
item.
Yeah, exactly.
And I've seen that, too, even with the radios, the transistor radios. You basically, you're going to have a display piece. If you can brush it out and clean it up, it's I think it would be too costly for most radios, unless it's the one you had to have to complete your collection of Lloyd's two transistor radios from the 50s. And this was the last one, and cost was no problem. Put the money in it. But otherwise, you've got a pretty cool-looking display item. And as Tom mentioned, there's guys that will collect radios just because they're RCA or just because they depict motor oil
mm-hmm.
or food products or baseball teams. And if it's the one you got to have and they all work except this one, you're going to put the money into it. But we've talked on another show with Tom here as a guest. Get it because you like it.
Right.
Don't get it saying, what's it going to be worth? Am I going to get skinned? If I pay $70, am I going to regret it? If it's something you want, you've got a fire and you've been collecting and you got a fire in your belly for everything and this is one of the last items you need, $70 is going to come back to haunt you if you don't pay it and get it in your hands. Because I've had that happen to me. Smitty, you and
I
have
all
had
that happen to us, yeah.
We sit there at lunch before these shows and talk about, you know, there's guys who go fishing and guys who go hunting. And the cliche with those guys is that they always talk about the one that got away. Well, in our world, Tom and Smitty and me, we always talk about the one that got away. There was that microphone, and I could have got it, but I didn't like the way the threads were. I had a little dent on it. And now you spend the rest of your life searching for that. So get the things you like, as with all collectibles. And Tom will know, because Tom gets people coming in and going out of his shop every day. They're either looking for something or they've got something that somebody else is looking for. Find a reputable person, such as our friend Tom, and get an idea first before you go taking a picture of it, put it on eBay, or taking it down to the pawn shop, or calling some guy who knows a guy who's related to a friend of your sister-in-law's brother's neighbor's ex-employer. That's where you're going to get hurt.
Yeah.
And Tom makes a good point, too. Don't tear it up and throw it in the trash. If you don't want to take the time, or you don't need the money, or don't think it's valuable, first of all, you should call somebody who knows something. But secondly, and most importantly, get it somewhere, even if you call the Goodwill. Have them come and get it. They'll find a home for it. This stuff's going away, folks. It's going away in the dumpsters, or in the trash dumps, or just getting torn up. And there are things that we grew up with in our baby boomer years that we won't see again. Take a picture of it before you get rid of it. I take a picture of everything I sell on eBay, Smitty, and I got pictures of everything since 99 when I first sold an item on eBay. At least I have a picture of that thing. I may never touch it again or own it, but I got a picture of it again. And we're going to take a break here at Galaxy. We're going to go to a retromercial. We've got our buddy Tom McCoy here on the show with us today, me and Smitty, and when we come back, we're going to talk about more novelty TVs and radios, and we're going to talk about some record players. You got your old Mickey Mouse record player? Don't go away, because we're going to talk about it, folks. And I hope you don't have that Mickey Mouse chair with it, because you're going to fall off of it when you find out what some of this stuff sells for. So don't go away. Be right back. Retromercial here on Galaxy Moonbeam Night Site on the Galaxy Nostalgia Network.
Be sociable, look smart, keep up to date with Pepsi. Drink light, refreshing Pepsi. Stay young and fair and debonair. Be sociable, have a Pepsi.
Hi, I'm John Coleman, and you're listening to Galaxy Moonbeam Night Site on the Galaxy Nostalgia Network.
Welcome back to Galaxy Moonbeam Night Site here on the Galaxy Nostalgia Network. I'm Smitty, along with my good buddy Mike B, and our guest today, our good friend Tom McCoy from Tom McCoy's Mantiques in Santee, California. And we're talking a little bit about novelty radios and television sets, and before the break we were talking about novelty radios. We're going to talk a little bit about novelty television sets. Tom, we also had mentioned the bar radios that went back to the 30s, but there was also, I'm sure you've seen at least pictures of it, there's also some bar television sets. You'd open up the door and you'd have the TV, maybe a phonograph and a radio, and there'd be a whole bar set in there.
Oh, absolutely, yeah. And talking about that, that was a different time, you know, because everybody smoked, everybody drank. They needed that television and bar combination to keep them at home, you know.
Sure.
So, also, they made a little, not the console, but a small table model called a portabar that had two whiskey decanters and highball glasses, and it was a radio. It's also, And I think it was made by the same company that made the smokerette that we talked about earlier in the show, yeah.
Oh, okay, great. Yeah. Now, one type of television set that a lot of people collect, I guess you could call it a novelty set because it's kind of a spacey-looking thing, and that is the Philco Predicta. And I know you've got one in your store right now, but tell us a little bit about what those predictors look like.
Kind of a space-age type television. It was made in the 50s. That it was a little box, and the tube was on the outside. It set on top of the box by itself, so you got a vision of the actual picture tube without being in the case. And that's what made it so interesting to have one of those. And they also made a taller version with a tripod, jet-age, space-age, if you will, type stand that it sat on. And the picture tube itself would turn 180 degrees, so you could watch it from any place in the room, you know. It was well-made and a very unusual piece.
Yeah, and those sets are pretty collectible. There's some people that really collect those Philco Predictas. I think a lot of those things that were made in the 50s did have that kind of that spacey, real sleek design. I guess that was part of that styling back at that time period, because we were talking about going to space and flying to the moon and rockets and all that was coming in at that time.
Yeah, in the 50s and 60s, yeah. The jet age or Jetson age or whatever. Yeah.
You know, you had the Sputnik, what, in
57? Yes, 57, yes.
We've done a show previously on that. But even the toys came out. You know, Remco was a big manufacturer of toys, mainly for girls and boys. Remco made one of the little ovens for the little girls to cook the cookies with, mm-hmm. make the cookies. But they also made space-age toys.
Mm-hmm.
And I remember Remco made one called a radio station.
Mm-hmm.
It had
yes.
little telegraph key on it. You could dial
it.
In. It was basically a crystal radio set with a space-age control center in plastic. And I had one of those. And that was so much fun because everybody had space on the mind.
Right.
It was the Eisenhower years. It was a few years before Kennedy promised to get a man
right.
on the moon by the end of the 60s. But it was space age, and even, you know, Tom, you've got some of those in this, or you mentioned some of those space, creepy space movies, those black and white ones about the moon and shot to the moon and things that happened and astronauts that were radiated during their orbit and they came back and they became colossal monsters and horrible things.
Yeah.
But and then the locusts, the grasshoppers.
Oh, yes, them, yeah.
James Arness, they're out in the desert. And I'll never remember. I remember this like it was yesterday watching that. I was terrified to go out in the backyard because you'd hear that vit, 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 vit. And you see the antennas up there, the feelers, and here come that grasshopper over that hill. And, you know, he eats one of the police officers, and then he comes after James Arness. But if everything was space age, and you notice a lot of the appliances start taking this shape, Tom. You know, the toasters started getting to look like little spacecraft. They were chrome and had little tails on them, and you've probably seen that. But even the radios.
Yeah.
You had a couple of items in the store. You've got some telescopes. Yeah, Tom McCoy's got, he's got the biggest, coolest toy room for big boys. Anybody I know, and he gets to look at all this stuff, but he'll get items come in and Tom, you get a lot of items come in, and it's like, what the heck is it, right?
Oh, yeah.
What could it be?
Yeah.
And 9 times out of 10, tell us about the espresso maker, because I know that's got to be from the 40s and 50s. This is an espresso maker, and it looks like some moonshot capsule device that they would send codes up to the space, but it's an espresso maker.
Yeah, it really is. It must have been a commercial unit for a restaurant, because it actually has a brass gas line underneath it that you hook the gas up to. I guess it's one of the reasons why our buildings burnt down,
yeah.
You know, because all the knob and tube wiring that we used to have on the outside of the and units like this, I mean, a gas line, if you can imagine, a gas line going to your coffee pot. But it's made out of brass, and it's porcelain lined. It's got porcelain handles on it. It's just really cool. Like Mike said, it looks like something right out of the space age. It's just unbelievable.
It's a neat item, and even the coffee percolators from the 50s, Tom, started mimicking. And these were not, we talk about novelty radios and TVs, we sort of segued into appliances, but these were still things that you plugged in and used on an everyday basis. And some of the hi-fi consoles started going in that blonde look instead of
the blonde
dark
look was very popular in the later 50s.
That reflected the space age, sure. And you had pedal cars. You know, typically a pedal car was a little ice cream cart or a tractor. In the 50s, you start getting pedal cars that look like rocket ships. X-15 rocket ship had a nose cone on it.
Yeah.
And even the record players would have pictures of the galaxies and a little rocket ship going off. And there was a little portable kid's record player. I think the guy who nailed it was Walt Disney. He knew how to brand merchandise because he'd take a movie, 20,000 Leagues Under the Sea, and for the next year, you'd have record players, 20,000 Leagues Under the Sea. You'd have costumes for Halloween. You'd have masks and you have toys. And, of course, the 20,000 Leagues Under the Sea board game that nobody could do without on Christmas 1961.
Yes.
And all this comes about, and it's returning. It's returning to the shops, much like Tom's, his Mantiques store. This stuff's coming back out. So you have another chance, folks, to take a look at this and get a game that you've had. Be it Chutes and Ladders or Candyland, there's a good chance, especially if you get in touch with a guy like Tom McCoy, at TomMcCoy'sMantiques.com, you can give him a call and tell him you're on the lookout for something. Is that right, Tom?
Oh, absolutely.
He'll find it for you. He's San Diego's original locator.
Exactly. Tom, give us the information again on your store and how people can find you.
The address is 11125 Woodside Avenue, Santee, California. It's a frontage road off of 67, right across from Santee Swap Meet. My phone number is 619-715-6955. And my website, again, is tomsmantiques.com.
Tom McCoy's Mantique. I'm running the guy's webpage, so I got to keep him in line. Or he's going to tell me nobody shows up. That's because they're going to the other guy.
Well, we sure thank Tom McCoy, our good friend Tom McCoy, for being with us again. And you'll be hearing Tom occasionally on our program as we, whenever we cover topics of collectibles and things. And Tom will come back and visit us again on our show, because we sure like to have him here, and he's such a nice guy. And even if you're not in the San Diego area, you can certainly contact him and talk to him. But that's just about all the time we have on our program this time. We sure thank you for joining us. We want to remind you can get a hold of us at galaxymoonbeamnightsite@gmail.com, galaxymoonbeamnightsite@gmail.com, and our website is galaxymoonbeamnightsite.com. And of course, you can find us on Facebook. And don't forget, also, all of our shows are on iTunes, and slowly we're migrating them all also to Mixcloud.com. That's all the time we have on our show. We thank you for joining us and hope you'll join us again next time. I'm Smitty.
I'm Mike.
And I'm Tom.
And until next time, folks, thanks for being with us, and we'll catch you again on Galaxy Moonbeam Nightside on the Galaxy Nostalgia Network. This is the Galaxy Nostalgia Network.